Before I call the meeting to order, I read the following notice. The meeting will be held for remote participation by the Board of Regional Commissioners pursuant to Massachusetts Governor Charles D. Baker's order suspending certain provisions of the open meeting law on March 12th, 2020. With that, I'll call the meeting to order and we'll stand for the Pledge of Allegiance. Pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States
of America and to the republic for which it stands,
one nation, to God, indivisible, and justice for all. And now observe a moment of silence to honor our troops serving our country here and overseas. Thank you. Okay. Under public comment, all public comments or questions should be directed to Beth Albert, County Administrator at BALBERT@BarnstableCounty.org. That's BALBERT@BarnstableCounty.org. The board will not respond to public comment and will not endorse any position taken by the author of public comment unless it determines the matter needs to be addressed at a future board meeting. The board will post any such comment on the agenda at the discretion of the chair. Okay, with that, I need a motion on the approval of the minutes if there are no corrections or additions.
Mr. Chairman, I move to approve the minutes of the Board of Regional Commissioners meeting of April 28th, 2021.
Thank you. Do I have a second?
Yes, second.
Okay, you have a vote. Commissioner Forrest?
Aye.
Commissioner Lyons?
Aye.
And the chair votes aye. Now we move on to general business. Traditionally, we start with Vera. Vera, have you got some numbers for us?
Good morning. I do. The numbers continue a positive trend downward. Yesterday afternoon, evening, there were 15 cases reported for Barnstable, decidedly lower than where we were a month and a half ago. New cases have also, in the last couple of days, for the islands have dropped as well. There were no new cases reported yesterday for both islands, which is great. Yes, we are well along at the other end of wave three. I would expect these lower levels to continue into the spring and summer and have a summer quite similar to what we saw last summer in terms of a few cases. The vaccination progress has helped this enormously, particularly on the hospitalizations side. So we are in very good shape at this time. There were fewer than 10 persons in hospital yesterday afternoon at 3, none of whom were in the ICU. So the trend is very positive. Vaccination efforts are going well also. They have tailed off. The demand is down. And so vaccinators are making plans to supplement their activities with additional outreach. Thank you.
Thank you. Any questions for Vera from my fellow commissioners? If not, I see that Sean is not with us, but I think we have Erica. Is that right, Erica? Do you have anything to add to what Vera said?
That's correct. So for the record, my name is Erica Woods, Deputy Director of the Department of Health and Environment. Yes, we continue to distribute the Pfizer vaccine at regular clinics at 4Cs. The registration definitely has, it's kind of like the bottom has dropped out, but we do have the impending approval for the Pfizer vaccine to be available to the 12 to 15 year olds, and they are going to start demobilizing those mass vaccination sites. And then, of course, we have the summer population coming in, so we do expect that we'll remain at least steady going forward. But we are working on different outreach campaigns to get down, shall we say, to the nitty-gritty and get to the vulnerable populations that we may have missed, but also possibly schools. All of the consortium members are experiencing the reduction in registration. We're all trying to make a shift to walk-ins, to being able to accept walk-ins. With that, we just have to make sure that we have the vaccine available for it. We have to be careful of not over-mixing so we don't have any extra doses at the end of it, and then registration. But that That's all items that we're working on. We continue testing. As a matter of fact, we're working on a clinic at the fairgrounds with Community Health Centers of Cape Cod to do both a vaccine and a testing clinic. Maybe we can kind of catch a little bit of both going through there. But other than that, we just kind of we keep moving forward on it.
Okay, thank you. Any questions for Erica on this?
I just have questions in general from the health department and the cooperative and everybody who's involved in this effort. You know, we are going to have, I think, from all predictions, a record-breaking year of people here because they've been pent up and they're ready to go and they can't fly anywhere, so or outside of the country. We don't know how many of these people are going to be vaccinated before they arrive. And there could be, oh, you know, we could have something, an episode. Are we preparing ourselves for a downturn or what could happen during the summer if people, I know in the summer it decreases, we're outside more, the restaurants are outside. So there's all of those positives with this negative. But I still think that we should be thinking about what if.
Yeah, and, we definitely don't want to get we don't want to get caught flat-footed. So, you know, again, we're going to continue the efforts with testing. I know Sonia and Bethany are putting together campaigns to, you know, keep the mask use going and keep the social distancing and keep all of that on the radar. We're hoping to work with the islands on that, too, so that it's not just us, you know, pushing that. But absolutely, it's definitely a concern that we have to keep an eye out for. And Vera will definitely see those trends moving up and give us the notification of, hey, guys.
Yeah.
The other thing that I hear, since I work in Provincetown and I deal with a lot of restaurant workers, there are some belligerent people. I mean, there's going to be times they're going to face people who do not want to mask if that is their rule coming into the restaurant, not so much outside the restaurant. And there's a belligerence. And I think it would be good if we came up with some sort of information campaign that, you know, everybody is ready to have a great time here. And don't take it out on our staff. We have been successful and we want to continue this success and be able to provide you a vacation. Mm-hmm. And so I think anywhere we can put patience and kindness and because there is going to be a shortage of workers. There's no doubt about it. That's already happening. No. The J-1 workers cannot get in. There's a backlog with the embassies. I did talk with Keating's office about a week ago, and it's not so much here as it is on the pipeline. So anyway, I am just concerned about, everybody's attitudes. And I just hope that we have a great summer and a fun summer and one that we're more cooperative in spirit and working to to just get through it. So anyway, I'm just going to say that. And those are the words I'm putting out to everyone, or something better than that, but along those lines. And but I do think that we should kind of put out like PSAs about what's the reality here, that there is going to be a shortage of, you know, patients and working with us is going to be better than working against us.
Yeah. Absolutely. It is, you know, again, I think, Sonia and Bethany absolutely can do that. And I know the task force is kind of thinking along those lines as well. And being a former restaurant worker, absolutely, we need people to be patient.
Right.
And Vera, when you do the number, there was a nice banner headline in the Cape Cod Times yesterday that Barnstable County was ahead of Massachusetts in the number of people being vaccinated. So we got a high five for that. Do we, when we use a percentage of people who are vaccinated, do we not use the people who are not eligible? In other words, do we eliminate the under 12 population and under 16 population?
No, we don't.
So they're included in people who are not vaccinated.
Well, yes, they're including everyone. They're including the Barnstable County population as understood from the census, not adjusted yet for the census count we just had.
The percentage of eligible people is much higher than what is being reported. In other words, we may have vaccinated 80% of the eligible population if you don't consider if you're not. I mean, I don't know what.
Yeah. I think it's, Commissioner, it's semantic. You know, everyone, you know, children as well as adults are able to contract and transmit the virus. So I think the denominator of the Cape, the population of Barnstable County is the accurate one right now, particularly since the age for eligible vaccine, the age for eligible to be vaccinated continues to drop. It's now going, next week it's going to drop to 12. So that's an additional chunk of eligible persons to be vaccinated in the county. All in all, I think it's appropriate to stay on the full population of the county, because that is the population base of that is susceptible to contracting COVID.
Okay, well, Mark wants to get in here, but the reason I ask that is because as Erica said, that we're, you know, there's fewer and fewer people coming forward to get vaccinated. We're running up against the limits. In other words, running up natural limits of the vaccine hesitant, and also those who are not.
That's correct.
Okay.
That's correct.
Okay, Mark, you have something?
Yeah, I have a few questions here, if you can just bear with me. One of my questions relates to the senior community. Last night, the Board of Health came before the Yarmouth Selectmen, and one of the things that I thought was very, very positive was the number of new cases, how that number is dropping off. And in Yarmouth, the number of new cases of people over 70 is zero. And what I'm curious about is if you can tell us a little bit about, is that a trend that's Cape-wide? Are we basically seeing very few new cases? That's true?
That is a strong trend, particularly cases as well as hospitalizations. I don't have access to the Maven system, which would allow me to look in on a daily basis for that information, but Erica's department does. But I think it's safe to say that is indeed a trend. The vaccines are working extremely well.
Yeah, also the outreach to the senior community has really accelerated in the past few months. That's the report that I'm getting.
It was job one.
And that's very positive. I'm just curious if you could shed some light on the areas that you're most concerned about. What worries me a little bit is looking ahead is that we've got this onset of all these new people. As you know, during the summer months, we're dealing with hundreds of thousands of tourists, people from all over, all different places. The thing that sort of nags at me a bit is making sure that we identify some of the other more vulnerable populations that are still out there with us and making sure that we're quickly getting out to them to make sure that they're fully vaccinated. You know, it's sort of like the clock is running. I don't want it to run out on us, where the closer we get to the season, we still have a very large percentage in a certain demographic that we need to get to. And I know that this is the most challenging, you know, in the beginning, we sort of got the low-hanging fruit. These are the people that were sort of on the computer every day, desperately finding an appointment and working on that. Those that were willing to hop in their cars or had the ability to go to Gillette or some other place. Now we're dealing with the folks that are perhaps the most challenging right now. And so my question is what do you see that group to be right now? And where do you see, what kind of efforts are we employing to really tackle that group?
So at this point, I don't have any specifics to share, just because we're tightening up details on it. But, you know, some of the populations, obviously, the school age population, the 12 to 15 year olds, once that becomes eligible, you know, the 20 and 30 year olds seem to be hesitant for whatever reason. So we are beginning to work on some campaigns and ideas to reach out directly to them. We also, there's a meeting tomorrow afternoon with some consortium members to develop a program of direct outreach to some of the vulnerable populations, individuals suffering with substance use disorder, different ethnic and national populations in the area that might be vaccine hesitant just because of where they're from. So we're specifically going to start targeting and doing kind of boots on the ground outreach. That's the goal from here on out. Like you said, what we've gotten so far is the low hanging fruit. You know, we started in the beginning with many more people wanting the vaccine than what we had for doses. And now we've kind of flipped over. So we definitely have to switch our strategies, and we are doing that.
Yeah, forgive me for sort of being the skunk in the garden party. I'm always focused on
somebody's got to be
those people that we need to get to. There's a tendency some arenas to be somewhat focused on all the patting of yourselves on the back or patting ourselves on the back. It's great to acknowledge what we've accomplished, but I think until we can get further through this, I think it's critical that we. And I think as a board, I'd like to be briefed and be aware of the things that we're contemplating and what we're thinking about doing, or at least I think that should be part of our briefings here as county commissioners, is we should get a better handle on exactly what we're doing, because I'm going to keep bringing these questions up, and I'd like to know exactly what we're thinking about, where we're targeting our efforts, and where we as a board of commissioners can be helpful to the extent that there are resources that are needed. You know, some of these efforts, I'm curious as to how they're going to be funded, who's going to underwrite them, where we're going to get the additional staff. I think these are things that it would be helpful to keep us abreast of as well. I feel like to some degree we're sort of in the dark on some of this stuff, and I would very much appreciate much more information.
Okay. We could absolutely get that together for next week's meeting. I'm not prepared for that, and I want to make sure that we have a couple of details nailed down before we, because again, we're still getting the specifics down, and I don't want any rumors to get out that don't come to fruition.
No,
but absolutely next week
I
we can give
that,
you some
Erica. Yep. Let me also say that I have been getting quite a few emails thanking the county health department for all the great work that you're doing. All right. So a lot of kudos that are out there that I just wanted to share with you. Everybody, there's a widespread sense out there that the county's done a great job. And we continue to get those emails and calls.
That is much appreciated. I got to tell you, our team and our staff have been, just working their hearts out to do this. So that means a great deal. Thank you. You're right. It's not over yet. We need to continue this. We need to reach out to those populations and bring in those people that are hesitant and get everyone vaccinated, or at least as many as possible.
I just want to add that what Erica was said that about the people coming in. I mean, we have workers coming in from other countries. And again, I can tell you, from my experience, for instance, one day I came in and there was about 13 people there from Jamaica who just arrived, and they all came in to sign up. And there was several that were just not sure if they wanted to do it to get a vaccine. So if we had information and I did talk to a lot of them, I said, look, I'm not the doctor. I'm just, if you really want to have their opinion, you can go to them. But let's think about what would be the alternative. Say you get it and you have like an underlying condition. Would that get worse? Would that be worse? I mean, these are things you have to think about. Not will it make it worse if I get the vaccine? What will it do if I get the virus? And let's think about it that way. And I said, you're going to be exposed to a lot of people from a lot of different places, and it's going to be very crowded. So you have to think about what is your vulnerability. And I think these are things that need to be said to people. I hope restaurant owners are really encouraging. I'm not sure if they're allowing people to work if they haven't been vaccinated. I don't know if they're able to do that, but it's something to reinforce, because there is some hesitancy from people from other countries. And I'm not just talking about Jamaica. I mean, I deal with countries from all over the place, so.
Absolutely. Absolutely. And that's one of the things, too, is that, the health agents are reaching out to their restaurants as well and getting them some of that information. But that's absolutely a concern, because, like you said, they're coming from all areas of the world. Mm-hmm. And just trying to get that accurate information out to them is important.
Right. Thank you.
There's just a quick couple of quick comments to Mark's comments. There are councils on aging and senior centers who keep records of people who are part of the vulnerable population. For instance, if there was a blackout, you know, or something, we know, they should know who's housebound and who has to be contacted. So, you know, it's lines of communication, which I'm sure exist right now, but it's a real team effort between boards of health, senior centers, and councils on aging to identify people who may still not be able to get vaccinated or have, you know, limited mobility.
Let me just respond to that, Mr. Chairman. I hear exactly what you're saying, and I think that collaboration has been crucial in terms of getting to a point where we're at zero new cases in some demographics from 70 over, at least in Yarmouth, zero new cases. That was great news to hear. What I'm concerned about is now that we've pretty much got a handle on that, it's focusing on these other demographics and building coalitions with a whole different constituency. Folks in their 30s aren't going to the councils on aging. They're not dealing with the traditional groups that we've been dealing with. So we've got to introduce ourselves to a whole new constituency, a whole new group of people. And these are folks that are much more resistant to the vaccine. I'm just amazed at some of the projections going ahead that there's going to be fairly sizable segments of the population in the United States that will not get a vaccine. And so are any national goals of herd immunity, some of the other national goals in terms of public health and safety and protection are going to be much more challenging. So I'd like to see the county sort of take a leadership role, as we've done in the past, on finding creative ways to tackle some of the more difficult segments of the population that are either vaccine resistant or at least sort of out of the loop, difficult to reach. We've done a great job on the seniors, but we've got these other groups that we really got to focus on.
Okay. The other thing I was going to say, which goes right to that, is we have to make it clear to people who do these walk-in clinics that there's going to be no questions asked. I mean, they're going to be asked their name, obviously, and perhaps their age, but there may be people in the hospitality industry who overstayed their visa or don't have a green card or even, God forbid, here illegally. That's not an issue for Barnstable County to worry about. We're worried about vaccinating people. So the word has to get out that if you come in and ask for a vaccine and you're eligible, you get a vaccination. So I think that could perhaps have part to do with, not a lot, but part to do with the hesitancy. Another thing that Erica brought up was the restaurant issue, and Sheila brought it up. And I think what the worst case scenario is, you have a customer showing up the door and they say, well, you can't come in without a mask. And they say, well, the governor said the rules are this, and the Board of Health says the rules are that. So there should be, if you walk into Provincetown Board of Health, or maybe even countywide, said, these are the rules. You know, so if somebody objects and says, well, I heard something else, we can point to it saying, when you cross the line into our town, these are the rules, and these are the rules we're going to enforce. Not to be mean about it, but just to avoid, you know, different kind of clashes. And my feeling is we don't want one restaurant dropping a dime on another, you know, and saying, well, how come I'm enforcing these rules? So as long as we get the word out that what rules, hopefully there won't be too many, you know, hopefully it'll be more open than it is now, but everybody should be operating on the same expectations.
Since you brought it up, I think we need to also be cognizant of that too. I think it's an excellent point. We're finding so much aggressive, and this is kind of what Sheila was talking about, is there's an attitudinal issue in some areas where people are much more hostile now. I mean, the airlines are reporting huge incidents of cases. We're going to have that problem. I would agree with you. That's going to be a very challenging one to address, and that is the overt aggressive non-compliance. And I don't know if anybody's got an answer to that, because as you know, the enforcement side of this has been very, very difficult. Mm-hmm. Before we had this ambassadors program, and I don't know if even that's still in existence, but going forward, the ambassadors program, we're going to have to equip people with body armor and helmets, I think, in the future. You know?
Well, hopefully we won't get to that.
Well, hopefully we won't, but that seems to be where what's happening in some areas.
Well, so far so good here. So let's hope for the best that we can keep civility and cooperation. Right. But I agree, we could turn, you know, there are some people who are just adamant and they want to have a fight. So we just have to know how to deal with that.
That's right. Cape Cod should be a happy place in the summer.
Exactly.
Right, there you go. That slogan will work.
I think. Yeah, I know.
Well, Eric, I think we've been on the hot seat long enough. Unless there's some other pressing matter to bring up with Eric,
yes. Or
let her go.
Thank you all.
Thank you very much.
Yep, and thanks, Vera.
Our agenda. The next item B, authorizing the endorsement of, well, why don't we get a motion on this, so we'll put it right on the floor. You have that in front of you, Sheila or Mark?
Yes, I do. I'd like to authorize the endorsement of the Chosen Mercy Otis Warren Award Committee, and it's being presented by Sonia Sheasley and Ed Maroney.
Yes, so to make it clear, we're not endorsing their choice. We're endorsing the committee. Is that
the committee? That's what it looks like to me.
Okay.
Can someone find this?
Have they made a choice?
Yes. Good morning, commissioners. And for the record, this is Sonia Sheasley, communications manager. We have Edward Maroney from the Mercy Otis Warren Cape Cod Woman of the Year Award Committee on the call. And he would like to present the committee's choice for the 20th annual award. Okay. So without further ado, Ed.
Yeah. Can you hear me, Sonia?
Yes.
Yes.
Okay. This may be for the best, but I haven't been able to turn my camera on.
Oh.
Aren't you a media guy? I mean, come on.
Yeah, not that kind of media, Ron. No.
Okay.
But it's nice to see everyone again.
It's good to hear you, Ed.
You are missing my Cape Cod tie, though. I put it on just for the occasion. I apologize. Well, let me just say, on behalf of the Mercy Otis Warren Cape Cod Woman of the Year Committee, I'm very happy to present for your endorsement our nomination of Wendy Northcross of West Barnesville. She was among many worthy nominees we were privileged to review this year. She not only shares a village with Mercy Otis Warren, but she exemplifies many of her characteristics, including the love of history, exemplified in Wendy being a co-founder of the JFK Hyannis Museum, and with her husband, Van, her mission to visit all the presidential libraries. We look for someone who is connected to the arts, education, business, community. They don't have to have all of those, but Wendy actually does. Former executive committee of the Arts Foundation, former chair of the Four Seas Trustees, the Chamber of Commerce, the Greater Hyannis Chamber, the Hyannis Rotary, affordable housing efforts in Barnstable, so much volunteerism. And of course, we look for a certain level of patriotism as well. And that all adds up to that. So because of all that and more, like Mercy, Wendy has spoken out and provided leadership on the issues of the day, wastewater, the economy, our aging canal bridges. And I think it can be said that when Cape Cod speaks with one voice, that voice is often Wendy's. So we'll have a celebration on June 2nd at 7:00 at Tales of Cape Cod, the old colonial courthouse. And once again, I commend for your endorsement our nomination of Wendy Northcross for Mercy Otis Warren Cape Cod Woman of the Year. Thank you.
Well, you want to make that motion, I guess.
Yeah, so moved, Mr. Chairman.
Okay, so before we vote on this, I just want to say I think this is an excellent choice, because Wendy has been a very, very brave person, and it goes to show you what a community college education can get you. I mean, she started there and has really shown what it is to be a participant in your community. And, you know, we all have an image of the Chamber of Commerce, and they're usually, how can we get things done and make it cheaper for that's the image some people have of the Chamber of Commerce. It's business first and everything else second. And she, with her very steady leadership, really did help the county in promoting the necessity of addressing wastewater. And where we are today, what happened in Mashpee this week, and what is happening across the towns as we speak of people addressing wastewater, where 10 years ago you would have had rocks thrown at you if you brought this up at town meeting, and you know that, Ron. You have a couple of scars to show that, and I think we all have some bruises still healing. But it's a great choice, and I thoroughly approve, and I think it's great, and I wish my sincere congratulations to Wendy and to Van. He's also a great community participant. So good choice. Thank you.
Thank you. I was on the phone call yesterday, or on a Zoom call with the opening task force, and Wendy has been running that show for several weeks now, and there's many 20 participants. She does a great job, and it's obvious that, you know, of the two issues that the county faces, the environment and also the business community, the economy, she's been on top of both because they're so interrelated, you know. So I also think it's an excellent choice. Robin, are you on the call, Robin Young? Have you got that motion? Robin?
Sorry, it takes me a second to unmute when I'm doing the minutes. I do have the motion.
Okay. And it's been
seconded. Would you like me to copy and paste that into
chat? Yeah, as long as we've got the motion, it was actually made by Maroney, but we'll assume that we got it. Okay, so I'll take a vote on that. Commissioner Forrest?
Aye.
Commissioner Lyons?
Aye.
And the chair votes aye. Okay. Well, congratulations, Wendy. I don't know what her plans are. I think she may be stepping down from something. Hopefully not.
I think she may be.
Before we excuse Mr. Maroney, can you just name some of the other folks on the committee that worked on this?
Good idea, yeah.
I
want to make sure we give credit to the full committee that worked on this. It's a great group.
I'd like to do that, but I don't want to leave anyone out, Mark.
Oh my God, I've got a media guy speechless here.
Put him on the set.
You're familiar with Judy Scarafile and Marcy right. Berman and Sue French and so many other people who have made contributions, and Kennedy, of course. Those are just a few quick ones, but they've been at it. Some of them, I've only been a member for a few years. Some have been on there forever, like Alice George.
Alice George,
back to the start of the whole thing. And I wish please
extend our gratitude and our appreciation for all their work.
Yeah. I will do that to everyone.
Thanks.
And don't be a stranger.
Thank you. Take care.
Thank you, Ed.
Okay, well, now we move on to item C, which is I'm going to turn this over to Beth, and she in turn is going to introduce Brian. Is that how we're going to work it, Beth? Okay.
Yes. Good morning.
Go ahead.
Yeah, I had asked Brian and Elizabeth to just provide an update, a status update on what they've been looking at in regards to the septic loan program. We're not ready to make recommendations today, but we certainly want to keep the commissioners updated on the work that's being done in-house as far as gathering information prior to making a recommendation. So I'm going to turn it over to Brian, and then I think Elizabeth has some information she wants to share as well.
All right, thanks a lot. Thanks for having me. Again, Brian Baumgartel. I'm the director of the test center, also environmental specialist with the health department. I'd like to share a quick screen with you here. I've just got a little summary slide. Can everybody see that?
Mm-hmm.
That there? Okay, good. And now I've lost, of course, my Teams window here, so I can't see everybody as I'm talking. There we go. So over the course of the last, you know, month or so since we last were here, we've really focused on getting our ducks in a row on this particular, proposal that's come forth. And we really, you know, kind of set out with the mindset of, you know, preserving the program to the best of our ability while also offering additional flexibilities toward the end that was sort of proposed for this. So I reached out to the Clean Water Trust, Nate Keenan over there, who is the deputy director of the Clean Water Trust, and kind of got a sense for what we'd be able to actually do in terms of the interest rate and so forth, because there are always, you know, the ideas we have, and then there's the reality of what we can do. So the options for the interest rate, if we are borrowing from the Clean Water Trust at 0%, and that's our current situation, all the money that we've borrowed, and we went out, I think, three times to get funds from the Clean Water Trust, we can loan it at 5%, or we have a choice of doing anything between 0 and 2%. if we borrowed at 2%, which is the current case with new funds from the Clean Water Trust, we could also loan at 5%, or we could go between 0 and 4%. The legislation behind this, the betterment loan, it's MGL Chapter 80, Section 13, for those who are curious and want to really get lost in some interesting legal terminology. It talks about, you know, the option of having 5, and you can do up to 2% above the rate that you borrowed at. So, as I said, if we borrow at 0, we could do between 0 and 2. If we do 2% borrowing, we could do 0 to 4% for our outgoing rate, which is kind of an interesting selection to me that you couldn't do 4.5, but you could do 5. But you never know with these things. The loan turn options are really also spelled out in that same MGL Chapter 80, Section 13. We can do a maximum of 20 years and a minimum of $5 per year of a payment. So if we had a fairly small loan that was divided up over monthly payments, you know, you could, in theory, end up with a $5 per year loan or less. So you'd have to shorten the loan term in order to stay in compliance with the regulations and the law. As far as, you know, our ability to change the rate without needing permission, we don't need permission from the Clean Water Trust to make any of these changes. You know, they loan us the money, we are contracted to pay it back. But other than that, we are able to change it within this legal framework at our discretion. And the same goes with the loan term options. So I had asked Nate a couple of other questions about some of the potential options for borrowing new funds. And I think Elizabeth is going to chime in probably a little bit on some of the procedural things for borrowing more. But I posed the question to him is if in some of these towns, they're putting in place what are called flow neutral bylaws. So they have to demonstrate if somebody wants to do a project in town, they have to demonstrate that they could fit a standard Title V system on their lot. It's to make sure that once sewers go in, we don't have crazy growth that's going to offset the benefit of having the sewer in the first place. So towns that put what's called a flow neutral bylaw in place are able to borrow from the Clean Water Trust at 0%. So I pose the question to Nate, would we as a county be able to borrow at 0% for loans made to those towns which have these flow neutral bylaws in place? And I don't have an answer to that yet. I'm hoping to get an answer back soon, but that would definitely, you know, really open up our options so that we're not loaning out sort of at a negative, you know, outgoing to incoming rate. You know, if we had to borrow more at 2%, that would certainly be very problematic really going forward for us. And Elizabeth, if you want to chime in sort of on the lifetime piece of what we had from the pro forma that you did.
Yes. Good morning. Elizabeth Bratcher, Finance Director. Yeah, I put together a 5-year pro forma based on the budget that we have that hits the administrative costs, the revenue that comes in, the debt service we have. And at our current rate, we won't run out of cash until 2024, 2025 at our current program. If we do change the interest rate, we have $14 million of outstanding loans right now that are at 5%. So that will continue to come back in and go into that administrative reserve that we have. If we do expand this to sewers, and we're gathering information now from towns of when they're expecting to go out, when they're expecting to have the influx of hookups and what that average cost will be. And when I get those numbers back, it'll be a little easier for me to plug that into the pro forma to see exactly where we need that infusion of cash. I've also reached out to folks that we worked with on the fire cleanup at the Clean Water Trust to find out what the length of time is to get the loan and what percentage we would be paying if we do borrow additional money from the Clean Water Trust. Like we said, we're putting this stuff together, so there's no definitive of where we're going to do that infusion of cash. If it's ARPA, if it's the Clean Water Trust, State Revolving Fund. I'll need those numbers from the towns also to see how much money we're going to need to borrow to keep this program running. So we'll have to come back with more information as we get it, and we'll continue to update you as we know more.
Yeah, I'll say that the pro forma is definitely trying to shoot at a moving target, because, I mean, as you all know, these wastewater plans, towns kind of put them in place, but there's a lot of flexibility built into them. So it's hard to predict when you're going to see big surges of sewer connections. I mean, you can get a decent sense, but, you know, a lot of this information just doesn't really exist. You know, Mashpee, of course, just on Monday got through town meeting with the $54 million sewer plan, but there's still, you know, the period of time it's going to take to actually get to shovels in the ground and people, you know, ready to hook up, which could be anywhere from, you know, and Andrew, I'm sure, could chime in on this, you know, anywhere from 2 to 5 years from now. So it can take a pretty long period of time as that project starts to really gear up and hit the road. And towns are really at different states in their planning process. So it's hard to predict really anything beyond the next maybe 3 or 4 years, what those rates of loan applications would be.
Do we have any questions on this particular piece of evidence here from my colleague? Yeah, Sheila?
Well, I need to wrap my head around this a little bit more. Is Andrew on the, he said Andrew, is this Andrew Gottlieb or Andrew?
Yeah, it's Andrew Gottlieb.
I am, Joe.
Okay, so Andy, do you have anything you'd like to say in support of going, you know, looking at this and what possibilities you as a selectman and APCC would, what your thoughts are on this?
Well, I think that what Brian and, you know, Elizabeth presented, you know, really helps begin to clarify down some of the issues here. I think it's, you know, enormously helpful to begin to get your mind around it. I think that, you know, there is, you know, Brian's right, there's an enormous amount of uncertainty about, you know, which towns are moving forward or what rate they're going to move forward. I would caution everybody in this conversation, if you need some degree of finite certainty around that issue, we're never going to move on this because it's always right. going to be a moving target. And so I think that, you know, setting some parameters of a scale that you're willing to put forward and, you know, develop a pro forma based on those assumptions, you know, Mashpee program, you know, we have 439 connections. Some subset of those are going to want to seek some public assistance for the financing. What's the assumption going to be? You know, I don't exactly know. But I think we can say, you know, X percentage of them are going to look for this. You can scale a program based on that, you know, and see where it all goes. I think that, Brian's recounting this conversation with Nate reflects the attitude that I got from Nate, which is there's a lot of flexibility here. And the state is, as long as the county is going to be paying back the loans to them, they're pretty indifferent about how we manage our own finances in order to do so. So I think that gives you as commissioners a lot of flexibility in how you want to scale this. And I think that one of the things you should give some real consideration to is, you know, utilization of some of these one-time funds that you have now to put into a fund that would allow you to kind of run your own reserve, your own revolving fund. So that, you know, you're relying on the repayment stream from our residents to fund that in perpetuity and have that be supplemented by what you get from the Clean Water Trust. If Brian's idea moves forward, they proceeded with Nate that for certain towns, you can gain the benefit of the zero interest because the underlying borrowing in the town has met the state's criteria. That's great. And that money then becomes free money you can add to the corpus of this. But I think, you know, your concern, Brian, about not owing the state interest money and then charging it back at a lesser rate and creating a structural burden on the county is an appropriate caution. I think you're extraordinarily well positioned, given some of the discretionary one-time money that you have available to yourself, to make that corpus fund donation from those funds and therefore not put yourself in a structural deficit that Brian's right to flag. So, you know, I think this is all really great. I think, you know, now, you know, take another a little bit of time to get some of those questions answered. And then I think, you know, setting up a parameters and a bunch of assumptions and saying we're going to launch a program based on this would be an enormous service to the communities. And, you know, you've got, you know, you've got obviously Chatham is moving forward with project where there would be some uptake to this. Harwich obviously has put, you know, pipes in the ground that are going to want to take advantage of this. Now Falmouth does too. But the rest of us, you know, Brian's right. You know, we authorized construction on Monday. We don't break ground until spring of 22. We don't have a system up and running into which people can begin to connect until 2024. So there's an enormous amount of lead time to figure out how this is all going to work. But I think having it out there and working, you know, the dynamics for Mashpee, just so you know, sort of a combination of the 0% interest loans, the money that came from the Cape and Islands Water Protection Trust Fund, and the knowledge that the county is conducting this conversation on how to mitigate the impact of connection fees on individual residents completely changed the conversation and the tone of our conversation at town meeting. So I think you guys have the one piece we haven't fully solved is the burden of connection to the system on the individual homeowner who's stressed. You guys are incredibly uniquely positioned right now to answer that question. And so I think, you know, getting that answer out that's yes sooner than later is going to let towns move forward with this, because that's the big question that's remaining. We've solved the municipal debt piece of it. We don't have yet a great answer on the person who needs to come up with $4,000 or $6,000 by some date to connect their house to the system. You have the ability to solve that problem. And I think based on what Brian said, Elizabeth said, the opportunity presents itself. The state's not an impediment. So you're in a great spot. I think it's all really positive.
Yeah, I agree. So thank you.
Mark, you had a question or comment?
Yeah, no, I agree with everything that's been said. I think that what I would recommend that we do is work quickly to at least set up a pilot program, make some basic assumptions. I'll just put my, for the moment, I'll put my Yarmouth Selectman hat on. We're having active discussions in three towns right now about a regional wastewater initiative, and having the county be able to sort of lay out this as one of the options for homeowners that need to hook up. To have that, since these discussions are going on now, the sooner we have a program like this in place, the more it helps those conversations. I agree completely with Andrew Gottlieb that and it's not just us that we're having these conversations, but other towns are as well. So waiting, I don't believe is an option. I think we need to sort of launch something relatively soon within the next few months. And I'm all in favor of using some of our ARPA funds to help subsidize or underwrite this effort. I don't think we should be intimidated by the size of this, but I do think if we start or consider starting as a pilot, maybe identify 1,000 or 1,500 and first come, first serve. And I think that's perhaps the best way to consider going. But I'd like to see us accelerate our thinking on this and come to a resolution on this relatively soon.
Okay, let me jump in here, because not only did I have to go through this in Chatham for 12 years, but I also have the sewer pipe going right by my house as we speak, or at least it did go by, and they are sewering some of Chatham in the area I live in, the Northwest, and also a great deal of East Harwich, because we overbuilt our treatment system to cover just such a scenario where Harwich may want to hook up. Now, the issue is that it's not like they run the sewer pipe past your house and then they give you a notice to hook up. The entire system is completed. In other words, they put all the pipes in first, then they put in the infrastructure, you know, the pump stations and so on. And then when everything, all the I's are dotted and the T's are crossed, the notices go out. So everyone gets a notice. So now, boom, everyone has to hook up within a year or 5 years. So what we're looking at now is we're looking at an ongoing program, but we're looking at fits and starts where all of a sudden you'll get 1,000 people want to hook up, and then we'll wait until, let's say, Mashpee comes aboard, and then we'll wait until Falmouth comes aboard. So I agree that we could get this program up and running as soon as possible. And it may be that, I mean, I don't have to worry about it, but there may be people who will be in my area that may have to take advantage of this. The two issues that we have to look at is, A, what is the cost of administering this program? In other words, we're going to need someone to vet the loans, and basically to manage it as though they were working for a bank. And the other thing, and eligibility, and how do we get paid? Brian, how do we get, and Elizabeth, how do we get paid for the loans that are out now? Do they send money directly to us?
Yeah, we send bills to them. They pay monthly, quarterly, I believe. The payments are processed, the checks are sent to us. Some people come in with cash, but mostly it's checks and credit card. We do have an online credit card option.
Yeah, I was wondering if there could be a system where we could get a betterment, you know, and the towns would collect the betterment and kick the checks to us, just because it would make it, you know, easier for the homeowner, you know.
Yeah, and that would be attached to their tax bill, whether the town is semi-annual or quarterly. Typically, it's paid in the first half of the year. If I recall, when I was working for a town, we did betterments. That is a little more convoluted if you go in that direction. And I don't know if towns would be amenable to that, but it doesn't hurt to ask the question. We are looking at new software. In the pro forma, I actually do have built in money for a loan officer to build this program. So we're happy to get into a meeting with everybody and start, you know, making some decisions around this.
All right. So it seems like we're going to have to, Brian and Andrew and Beth are going to have to find out whether or not we can borrow the money at 0% if the towns have this, I call it a growth neutral bylaw, or we have one in Chatham where if you can't put in 10 extra bedrooms just because you're hooked up to the sewer. Yeah, you're limited to what you were previously allotted, which helped, as probably Andrew knows, to get the whole thing passed. Because some of the opposition were from people who felt that it would increase development. So that was important. And I think a lot of the towns have that. If we can, so that's one question. Can we borrow the money from the trust at 0%? The other question is, how much is it going to cost us to administer the program? And the third question is, do we want the county to kick in some of the monies, assuming that we can use the money for that purpose? And it's basically revenue neutral. In other words, not going to cost us anything in the long run to do that. And so those are the kind of questions we have to answer. And, but I'm absolutely convinced, and I know from what Mark and Sheila have said, that we're going to go ahead in this program in one form or another, as long as it's financially viable for both the county and the applicants. So we've got that part of it settled. We're moving ahead. Now it's just, as I said, to dot the I's and cross the T's and understand where we are on a legal basis with the agreement of the legislature and the governor. Elizabeth, what do you have to say? You got your hand up.
Beth had her hand up first. I'll defer to Beth.
Thank you. I just wanted to weigh in on that. So we've been meeting weekly internally to get, as you say, dot the I's and cross the T's. I thought it was important to give an update today. I'm really pleased with the reaction and the feedback that we've gotten. So we will continue to work on this. I think looking at a pilot project may be something we want to continue, as Mark suggested. And as far as the ARPA money, as you know, we do not yet have guidance from Treasury on how these funds can be used. We're watching this closely to see what are some of the eligible uses, but certainly this is on the table. So thank you, and Elizabeth.
Okay. Yeah, I was just going to mention too, where we need to find out if we can use it as a revolving fund, which would mean, you know, the ARPA funds, and then get the money back for that would make it a revolving fund. So we're still waiting on that guidance as well.
Okay. And
the commissioner, go ahead, Mark. Do you want to say something?
Yeah, I want to say that I think in looking at the ARPA funds, if yes, one option, I would agree with you, one option should be to use those funds to help capitalize the program. But I think another option to consider as well is whether or not those funds can be used to underwrite our costs to operate it, making it easier to run it as a 0% program. So I think we should look at a multiple of possibilities in terms of how those funds can be used to support this. It may very well be if we can use, you know, the revolving loan fund dollars to create, you know, to expand this loan program, then it may make sense to go after more of those dollars and then use some of the funds that have been set aside for us to cover the cost of operating it. So I don't want to get into the weeds in terms of how we should do this, but I think we need to be expansive in terms of our options on how we pursue this.
Brian, did you have something to add?
Yeah. Just my really brief reading of the ARPA legislation. I mean, it does specifically spell out water and sewer infrastructure projects, necessary investments in those things. And this is definitely a necessary investment to me. And the other thing I guess we'd have to sort of work out is they do set a sunset clause on the ARPA funds, and we're definitely talking 30-year plans here. So we're going to have to figure out longer term sustainability if we're going to rely on that to start with. Because as we were saying, you know, a lot of these sewer plans are not really shovel ready within the next, you know, 2 to 3 years. So we're going to have to sort of work that piece out. The other part of this is that some towns aren't going to be relying on sewers at all, particularly on the Outer Cape. Wellfleet, Truro are looking more at innovative alternative septic systems. So to have some of these funds available for those folks as well is definitely a critical aspect of this program.
Okay, thank you.
So just to wrap my final comment, and then I'll be quiet, is we're looking at covering betterments. Right, we're looking at covering septic system upgrades, and we're looking at alternative septic systems. Those are sort of the three areas we're going to be looking at for an expanded program. I just want to make sure that's clear. Okay.
I don't know if we can cover the betterments on that. I mean, you're talking about betterments that would be assessed to people who are provided with the sewer by the town.
I think that needs to be examined.
All right. Well, that's another issue I think that we'll look at, but. The immediate issue right now, and I talked to Beth about this, we've received communications from a couple of towns signing on to Mr. Gottlieb's recommendations, suggesting that we lend them the money at 0%. And I understand that that's a good possibility, but we're going to have to respond to them in some general sense after this meeting and say, look, we're looking into this. These are our options. And as soon as we know, we'll let you know. But that we're definitely, the Barnstable County Board of Commissioners are committed to this program, and we're going to do whatever we can to augment the town's efforts. So basically, I don't know who will write that up. Somebody will write it.
I'm comfortable with saying that, Mr. Chairman.
Okay, good. So we'll make that understanding. Sheila, did you?
Yeah, I just also want to agree. I think this is an opportunity for us. So even if we do take what we can from the Clean Water Trust, to take money now, because this is a one-time thing for a long time. We're not going to have this moment in time for many, many years, to take that and set it aside and see how we can make that grow, because this will change the federal government. Their resources will change, and we have to be able to be prepared for those, for the future, for when there is no place else to go other than ourselves. So I agree with that. I also think it encourages towns to adopt a flow neutral bylaw as they're going forward, because that will sort of cap what everybody's fear is, even though that fear has long been gone. It proved itself out by not sewering. And even though towns right now, they're sewering, there's pipes being put in the ground in Provincetown. I have to drive around through detours all the time. And Wellfleet may be more amenable to doing something with their downtown area. If this came true, because businesses we can't have a business on Main Street anymore because of the septic system. So it's a dying little Main Street other than a clothing store. You can't have a restaurant. It's tough. So I think this is all good. I think the word should be that the county is committed to making it work. And it's just a matter of some of the details being worked out. But rest assured, it will be there. And thank you, Andrew, for supporting this and bringing it to the attention of everyone, because it's what we should be doing.
Okay, I'm going to ask a question before we relieve this.
I just think, you know, Barnstable County is incredibly well suited to this task. It's a great,
I agree.
It's a great thing for Barnstable County to be able to do.
I agree.
All right.
It shows what we're supposed to do.
Now, Elizabeth and Beth and Brian, is what are we talking about for a time frame that you feel guys will feel comfortable coming back to us with some of the information we're asking for and some recommendations? I mean, we're talking a month, 2 months, any idea?
I'll let Beth answer.
Oh, okay.
No.
That's what you get for getting the hot seat.
How about we say we'll come back with something in 3 to 4 weeks?
That's fine. That's lightning speed.
Is that reasonable?
Mm-hmm.
Lightning speed.
And we'll see where we are. We'll see where they are. I mean, we can provide updates in between. And if that's not reasonable, I don't know, Brian, does that sound reasonable?
I think so.
Okay. And Elizabeth?
Yes.
All right. Mm-hmm. Thank you.
All right. Well, we'll look forward to that. And say no commitments, but just to give people a heads up that we're on this and we're continuing to look at it. So, okay. Well, thank you very much. And
excellent.
It's all good news, I think. And now we move on to new business. I have no new business to go before the board. Either of my fellow commissioners do.
Can I make an announcement, or is that at the end? I just want to put a couple of things out there, community service announcements. But I would like to just speak up for the Human Rights Commission this Friday. They are having a forum online. You can, I think they've done some PR out there, so look on your emails or Facebooks, but also on the county website. And it's ending the arc toward housing equity. So it starts at 8, I think 45 in the morning, but be there at 8:30, and it goes to 1. And they really do have a great set of speakers from state and housing advocates. So I just wanted to put that out there. The Human Rights Commission is working very hard to bring attention and education to people. So I want to commend them for that and support them. And I also just wanted to congratulate Andy and the board and the town of Mashpee for their unanimous vote on Monday night on the water. It was really quite a feat. And
yeah,
that was just great news. So congratulations.
I think it's an example of how the political atmosphere has changed since we went through this in Chatham, because it was an enormous debate. But in the 10 years since, the 14 years since, people have realized what an issue this is. And I think the towns are coming around, the towns folks are coming around to the realization that they have to do something about this. And now is the time to act. So I
want to that point, Ron, I just want to say that the county did take on some leadership. It was the Cape Cod Commission. It was our water collaborative. And at that time, it was Andy. And it really was an education. This is an effort of educating the public and showing them the problem and then coming up with incredible solutions to help them afford that. So it was a long haul. It didn't just happen by accident. And another reason why Wendy should be Mercy Otis of the Year, because she did support this. So it's been a big effort by a lot of people, and I just want to make sure they all get credit, because it's been a long haul, but it goes to show you hard work and patience does pay off.
Okay, so I don't want to go further down. But thank you. Now we'll move on to commissioners' actions. Do I have a motion? I want to discuss item A briefly. Do I have a motion on item A? One of my commissioners?
So
my computer went off.
Would you like a motion, Mr. Chairman, on all of them and then just pull out one or two just to get some clarity on? Would that be okay? Or do you want to go through the individual?
We only have four.
Yeah, let's go through them.
Let me go through them. Sheila, Mark, you want to make a motion on A?
I would like to make a motion on authorizing the execution of a year-long no-cost performance extension of the Herring Grant sub-award 2804-SA from C Grant 2804 for a one-year period of January 31st, 2021 to January 31st, 2022 for Abigail Archer.
I'll second this. I have questions about this as well.
Yeah, I don't see Abigail on the list. Mike, do you want to take that? Mike McGuire?
Sure. Can you see me?
Yes, I can.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Let me just lay out my question, and then rather than giving a long dissertation on what's going on, I'm very supportive of this. I just don't understand why in our motion we have a reference specifically to Abigail. That's what I don't understand. Why do we need to name an individual on this particular motion? It sounds like we're allocating money to a person.
Yeah, it's a no-cost extension. We're just changing the dates. Abigail's the PI, principal investigator. So she is specifically named in this grant funding. We as a county do not need to mention her name. We just need to approve the change of dates. The funding agency understands that we need more time with this, so they're going to give us another year. In the future, I can try to make sure that individuals are not named in the motions.
Well, I think Abigail does a great job. She's fantastic. And it looks a little awkward when we see in the motion that we name an individual. That's all. But I'm comfortable with the motion, understanding that the money's going to Cooperative Extension to pay for her work. Thanks for the clarity. Appreciate that.
They just like naming her as the PI. So
got it.
Great. Mike, give us a brief explanation of what you're doing in regard to Herring in this.
Well, there's quite a bit going on. We're measuring how the number of animals or fish going through the run, and then doing some habitat restoration work. But it's, instead of going into all the details, because we have three or four different projects going on, I don't want to miss.
No, that's all right.
I don't want to refer to this particular project rather than another one. So it's essentially restoration work and some population studies to understand how many fish are in each of the runs.
All right. Is there any case where they're trying to restore historical herring runs that no longer are viable because of barriers and so on? Is there anything going on like that?
Yeah, so that's been ongoing, and Commissioner Forrest actually is has been very involved with some of those efforts too, and can speak to those. But yes, the state has a list. All of the major, the big runs have had a lot of work done on them, and we're ticking away at this, mid-size and then smaller runs. And a lot of that has to do with water rights, water flow, how they interact with cranberry industry, et cetera. So, but yes.
For homeowners.
Yeah. All right. Well, because there's even by me, there's used to be anadromous fish runs, and that one reason there was blocked in the history and no longer get eels or herring or anything else. So something.
Can I respond to that, Mr. Chairman?
Yeah, sure.
Yeah, the Cape Cod Conservation District in the Natural Resources Conservation Service, as some of you know, I work very closely with them. I head up the conservation district, and we're doing a huge inventory, working with a number of stakeholders, a number of groups, to identify new herring run projects. Abby used to actually work for the conservation district, and she came over to work for the county. And there's a significant amount of federal and state money involved in these projects for the county. But given what the county's doing, it leverages and supports so many other collaborative efforts. If you ever wanted to understand and study collaborative public management or public administration, what the county's doing in this space is very significant, very important. It leverages a lot of other things to happen. So our role at the district is to help get the money for these projects. But we rely on the work of the county to help figure out how best to design them, how to coordinate them, and get funding to the towns. But we have the state involved, the federal government, all the agencies that need to be consultant to be involved in designing these things. It's an incredibly complex, and we're just talking about herring runs.
Yeah.
I mean, that's just one area. Multiply that several times over, and it's an enormous amount of work, but the herring run stuff is very important. I applaud all the work that's going on with Cooperative Extension and the federal funding that's going to be coming to the Cape, by and large, will as a result of a lot of these collaborative efforts that the county plays a very active role in.
Yeah, if I can just add to that, I think this is really where we shine, is that data collection to support efforts. I mean, there's a lot of you can kind of see it, but you need to back it up, your assumptions. And that is really the work that the cooperative has been doing. It is the crucial piece in the big puzzle. And thank you for that. And, I agree with Mark. It is a complex thing, but it goes to show you how all these pieces get together and actually accomplish something in the end.
Thank you, Commissioner Lyons. Abigail is one of the New England's premier anadromous fish researcher. She has a lot of respect. Having the county support her position, have her around, allows us to attract the funds, the federal and state funds. And she's been doing some really interesting work with RFID tags, so we can actually monitor individual fish when they come up, when they go down. Sometimes they go missing, seagulls, raccoons. But it's a very interesting thing. And the net result is when we have hard data, we can advocate for certain things. And there was a lot of discussion about pushing offshore trawlers into or farther offshore. And having some data on our alewives and herring was important in that conversation as well.
Mm-hmm. I think that rule was passed to push the trawlers offshore.
Yeah, it has. They're in federal court trying to appeal it, but yep, it did pass.
Well, you know, the thing is, these fish, the anadromous fish, are part of an entire ecosystem. It's not just the kids grabbing herring at the run. I mean, they're part of and an ecosystem that goes out into even bigger predator fish that sometimes, you know, striped bass and bluefish used to come inshore. Now they tend not to when the herring populations are low, you know. So that it, and of course, there's plenty of seagulls out there too who are applauding Mike's work and Abigail's work. But
we're all part of the food chain.
Yeah, we're all part of the food chain. So yeah, no, this is something dear to my heart. So I don't want. So we have a motion on the floor. Been moved and seconded. I'll call for a vote. Commissioner Forrest?
Aye.
Commissioner Lyons?
Aye.
And Bergstrom votes aye. Okay. Just quickly on this one, Christy, are you on the line? Christy? Hello? Or someone on this? Well, why don't we get a motion on it? On B.
I'll go ahead and move it, Mr. Chairman. I move to authorize the execution of a contract with the University of Massachusetts Donahue Institute in the amount of $100,000 to provide technical assistance to the Cape Cod Commission for conducting and analyzing surveys of new and second homeowners for a period from May 5th, 2021 to November 30th, 2021.
Okay, we have a second.
Yeah, I'll second this. This is kind of a study that they have done in the past of asking, now that you have your second home, do you think you'll live here? It's sort of trying to predict our demographics of the future and where we are today, and it's very important. So definitely second.
Yeah, okay. Yeah, it's part of a bigger piece of understanding affordable housing and where we're going. Mm-hmm. It's pretty much self-explanatory. So I'll call for a vote. Commissioner Lyons?
Aye.
And Commissioner Forrest?
Aye.
And Bergstrom, aye. Okay, the next one is pretty much pro forma, a contract.
I will move that to authorizing the award of contract two and execution of contract with Gibson Roofs for the replacement of the health department roof in the amount of $151,700. Gibson Roofs was selected. Did I say that right? $151,700. Gibson Roofs was selected as the lowest and most responsive bidder, offering the lowest price for the health department roof replacement per bid number 7940.
Okay, do I have a second on that?
Yes, I just did.
Okay, all right, so I'll call for a vote. Commissioner Lyons?
Aye.
Commissioner Forrest?
Aye.
And Bergstrom, aye. Okay, item D is going to call for some explanation.
Yes, authorizing the execution of a consent to default by Eastern Bank against Terrapin Ridge LLC regarding Home Investment Partnership Program, our home-funded project entitled Terrapin Ridge, situated at 1-31 Terrapin Ridge, Sandwich, Massachusetts.
I will second that.
I do want to know about this.
I have no idea what the heck we just seconded.
Yeah. Well, Renee Hammond is on from the home program manager to give you the details.
Okay. Good morning. This is Renee Hammond, home program manager. Can you hear me okay?
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Okay. So this is a home funded project from it's Terrapin Ridge and Sandwich. It is a 30 unit residential development. It's all affordable units. They range from 30% AMI to 60%.
AMI, which is area median income. This project came through through home funded and home funding and was granted $250,000 in HUD home funds as part of a financing package to have the project developed. Terrapin Ridge was the project developer. They are actually owned by Women's Institute Realty. I did provide we did have the attorney, Michael Dutton, look into this, and we provided a memo to you from him. So what occurred is the financing was done in August 10th of 2020, and the project began development. It was actually almost three quarters of the way through construction that Women's Realty folded, and that kind of left the project hanging. Eastern Bank is the construction lender on this project, and they took over the project, and they are going to bring it to fruition. They're going to continue the construction. Actually, right now, it's just about finalized, and they're awaiting their certificates of occupancy, and they are started to lease up. But with Women's Realty folding, Eastern Bank had to take control of the project. They wanted to keep it going. They didn't want to lose this project. And what they're going to do is they're going to see it through the end and then locate another nonprofit developer who can take over the project and manage it moving forward. So what they are asking for is all the lenders' consent to allow them to do this, to finish the project, bring it to completion, find a new nonprofit developer to take it over so we don't lose the project. And as you can see, there's a lot of other funders. There's about seven or eight of them, including a lot of state agencies, CDAC, those type of agencies who are all involved in this. So we have all been talking about this and moving forward with this. I'm very comfortable with Eastern Bank taking over the project. They've done this in the past. This is the first time this has happened in the 25 plus years of the Bonsall County home funds. But I think we've done the best to keep this project moving forward. I do want to state that we did grant them a $250,000 grant award from the HUD home funds. We have not released any of those funds as of yet, and we will do so once the project is completed and we know that a new nonprofit developer is taking over. So I don't think there's any, risk. Liability here for the county. The project's going to be completed. We're going to release the funds once it's completed, and we're going to keep this this project going, which again is 30 affordable rental units in Sandwich. I can answer any questions.
Any questions on that? I have a question. This, when you say we're using HUD funds, is this simply a pass-through?
Yes.
I mean, so it's not really county money to begin with. We just act on behalf of housing. Housing and urban development.
Okay. Yes, that is correct. We have a duty to make sure that the HUD funds are being used properly, and I'm confident that we are doing so in this case.
Well, it's very good news that this project is going forward. We had a similar project, all affordable in Chatham. We're called the Lake Street Houses, and I think it's one of the premier affordable housing projects on the entire Cape. And it does, as this one does, have different tiers of affordability. As far as the medium income in Bonsall County. So whatever we can do, at least from my standpoint, whatever we can do to make it happen, it's well worth it. So if there's no further questions from my commissioners.
I do want to thank Eastern Bank for this, because they did take control right away and kept the project moving, and now it's almost completed. So that was a great on their part.
Yeah.
Okay, thank you. So I'll take a vote. Commissioner Lyons.
Aye.
Commissioner Forrest.
Aye.
And Bergstrom votes aye. Do we have septic betterments, Robin? Hello?
Sorry, Chair. It takes me a second to unmute. No, we do not have any septic loan betterments this week.
So we don't need a motion.
Okay.
All right. Now we have commissioners' reports. I have nothing to report since I talked to you last week. Do I have anything for Commissioner Forrest or Lyons?
Comment as Sheila did, the vote in Mashpee, the unanimous vote to support the clean water, the phase one, $6 million. I think one of the things that I thought was incredibly impressive about that vote was not just the unanimity, But the extent to which all community leaders were sort of speaking with one voice, and I think the part of the lesson in this is not giving up. These discussions regarding clean water and wastewater are discussions that have been going on for some time in Mashpee. And I think one of the reasons, and Commissioner Lyons and you, Mr. Chairman, you've commented on this, that the timing is now, because we have sort of the stars aligned. And with the money, with the resources, with the support of the state, all these other funding sources, all the pieces are beginning to fall into place. And I think it's terrific that the county is looking at the way it can play a very, very positive role and constructive role in finding ways to expand the septic loan program into these other areas. I can't overstate it enough of how critical a county program that augments this effort will go in terms of providing yet another reason why towns can say yes to wastewater projects as they're being teed up in their communities. These discussions, like I said before, in Yarmouth, they're going on. And so I'm excited about this development. To see a unanimous vote is just sort of unheard of on these projects. So it's important to recognize the timing is now, and the timing for the county is now.
Okay.
So if I can just add to that, because this really is a historical lesson in some ways. The biggest, if we had said this was all going to be done for free 12 years ago, people wouldn't have had a problem. But when you said, we really need you to understand the seriousness and to buy in that we need to fix it, that helps make the argument of getting the money. Where are you going to get the money? And when people said the money will come, it's crafting how we're going to get it, but we need to know we have the support of the people. So everybody wants to be negative at first and fight things forever. And we had, and it really was a community effort of educating and showing people, number one, the seriousness of this problem. Yes, it did impact them directly. It was going to impact their homeowner, the costs of their home, the appreciation of their home, the appreciation of their community at large. So this was a long thing, but everybody's initial thing is mistrust. It's not going to happen, and yet it does. So we have got to have more faith in our government and in the people who we hire, who are ourselves going forward. There's very smart people we have here, And I just can't say enough about that effort and how successful it was. So this is a lesson for all of us to realize that if we want to get it done, we can get it done, and we've just got to go forward and not be afraid of what's this going to cost me as the individual. It's really a bigger picture here that we have to take care of. Yeah. So again, congratulations, Mashpee.
Okay, it's funny, I was thinking about this. I don't know if you remember Selectman Ed Lewis from Brewster, but Ed.
Much remember Ed Lewis.
We have to tax short-term rentals and use that money for the purposes, one of these purposes. And we used to call it the Ed Lewis bill. And he seemed frustrating at times, but eventually he was successful. And that started, I didn't start the ball rolling, but it really moved us ahead with the revenue stream. It's brought us, along with other things, to this point. So Ed's still with us. He showed up on Facebook the other day, so you're down in Florida. But
I know I have to say hi to Ed.
Part of the credit will go to him. All right, Mark, do you have anything else for us, or Sheila?
If not, no, other than the human rights.
Yeah, I'll move on to.
We're all set. Are you ready for a motion to adjourn? No. Or do we have to hear from? Does Beth have anything else for us?
Oh, Beth has an update. Does she?
Actually, I don't have anything pressing, so I will defer. But I think Elizabeth had two quick updates. I want to give her a moment to do that.
Yeah. Come on, Elizabeth. What do you got for us?
Hi, everybody. Elizabeth Bratcher, Finance Director again. First update, CARES Act reimbursement. We just got notification we're getting just north of $271,000. You will be getting the paperwork at your next meeting to sign off, and that money will be coming forthwith. It will be reimbursing the emergency fund where we paid for most of our response to COVID out of, which includes PPE, the plexiglass that we put in place, the health agents that we hired, and amongst other costs that we incurred during that time. So that's great news. The RDO group is working on our FEMA.
I have a question on that, Elizabeth.
Absolutely.
Mr. Chairman, I just a quick question.
Go ahead.
Elizabeth, I'm glad you brought that up. That's a very timely observation. There was an editorial in today's Boston Globe criticizing county government, including Barnstable, for being incapable of managing federal funds being used to deal with COVID. And I think it's very timely that you brought this announcement, because clearly Barnstable County has shown and demonstrated that it is very capable of managing federal relief to deal with this crisis. One of the arguments in the editorial, just FYI, was that this money somehow should go back to the state so that it can be re-diverted in some way to the individual towns, because they would be doing a better job in managing it. So I've received some calls on that this morning. I've explained to people that obviously the Globe has no idea what Barnstable County is all about. Barnstable County is fully capable of managing these programs, managing these dollars. In fact, we can do a better job than a lot of other folks that may be touted as being able to manage these folks. It's very efficient. In fact, who knows, maybe in the future we can help the towns as they struggle theoretically in how to manage these funds. So thank you for that update. That's very helpful, and it's very timely.
Yeah, and I'd like to see what the towns are going to do with their stimulus money, because that will be an interesting thing.
Well, I'm glad to say that this conversation came up in the conversation we had yesterday with Senator Sear. Apparently, the federal government, you know, across the country, county governments are really strong organizations to put on services, including police and fire. So when the distribution of the funds came around, they decided to go directly to the counties with a lot of money. And, you know, in Massachusetts, they're not as strong as they are elsewhere, but they followed a similar course.
With the exception of Barnstable County.
Exactly.
Now, Plymouth County, not to mention any names, everybody's mouth, because they got a bunch of money the last session around, which they basically husbanded themselves. I'm waiting for us to get that check in the mail, because that Boston Globe article is just sort of a stalking horse toward other organizations, including the state and towns. They're going to try to glom onto some of that, but hopefully it's not going to happen, because as Mark said, we, and you've said, Sheila, we are as strong an organization, a local organization, as exists anywhere in Massachusetts and possibly in the country. So, and I also discussed at that meeting that we will talk to the towns and other organizations about how best to use that money. I mean, the towns are going to get a revenue stream. There'll be other revenue streams go directly to businesses. We have to sit down and see how we fit into the bigger picture and how we use our money most effectively along with everybody else. So it's not going to be just us. But yeah, you're right.
Since you brought that up, Mr. Chairman, about the towns, let me just say one thing real quick. The towns, one of the reasons why, and let me just preface this by saying I'm friends with the treasurer of Norfolk County as well as the treasurer in Plymouth County, and I've been staying in regular contact with them just to kind of get a sense of what they're doing going forward. And one of the things that Plymouth County is at least considering is not accepting the funds, but indeed passing them through, because they've begun to start looking at their requirements for managing these dollars, and they've recognized that they're quite onerous and they're quite challenging. And the thing they're wrestling with is it going to be more of a burden to the towns? And to what degree might it be a burden for the county? To what degree do they have adequate capacity? So we should all go into this knowing that, you know, just flipping the money to a community, let's say like Wellfleet or Truro, may in the abstract seem appealing. But what can happen is they can just clearly be overwhelmed with the responsibility of managing, you know, significant grant dollars. And there's some penalties that go along with this as well. So, I appreciate the Globe going to bat for the towns, but in some cases, there are going to be towns that don't want this money. They'd rather have somebody else manage it for them. And I do think as we, as and I know Beth and the team are working on plans and recommendations for us, and that's going on in earnest, that I think one of the things that would be helpful to offer is help to the towns that end up at least having to manage their own money, because they're all getting individual allocations as well. Because it's going to be a challenge to manage these dollars.
Well, if you'd like that update, first I'd like to say thank you to Julie Ferguson, because she worked very hard on the CARES Act reimbursement and made that happen in the departments that worked with her. The second thing is the FEMA money. FEMA's reimbursing counties and towns at 100% this round. So we set up that $1 million that we voted to go towards the vaccination sites, and we're tracking it in a separate fund. And we're working with the FEMA and MEMA group and putting in our first reimbursement request. They asked and are allowing us to do it in smaller increments, so we're not waiting to the end of the project. Our first one will be through the end of March, and then we'll do it monthly thereafter. So we have a weekly meeting with the RRDO group, and we're getting that organized. They have everything together. We put some things in place. Right from the get-go, we asked the departments to give us the invoices as they come in, so we're not waiting to the end. The assistant treasurer gets the checks, the canceled checks, to Julie to coordinate, and the other two folks, Bobby and Quan, are helping out with the wages and stuff for different areas, like the food excess coordinator, as well as the additional hours for the MRC nurses and all of the contractor nurses for the vaccine sets. It's great stuff. So we'll be seeing that money coming at a more regular pace than waiting to the end. Then the other real quick update was update on registry numbers for April. They came in at 1.7 million. We are currently 5.7 million over what we budgeted, with two more months to go, estimated about 8 million over what we budgeted for the year.
Unreal. So
I'm hoping we can do some reserve fund.
Yes, exactly right. We have to, it sounds like we could have a party, but let's not. Yeah. Let's be
On that FEMA money, I mean, this just another example of how of the value of Barnstable County, because rather than wait until the money came down to do it, we could act, you know, and the commissioners, I'll pat myself on the back, decided at that point, they said, let's put $1 million of the reserve right in there to we can act right away with the expectation that we would get it back. And sure enough, we are getting it back now. So part of that, I mean, it's such a team effort, both financially and operationally, in responding to the COVID crisis here on the Cape. So,
as government should work.
Yes, it works. Now, with
one
that
quick update,
one
Mark,
more,
be happy
more thing.
To know.
One more.
Oh, sorry. The last update is the financial review of DOR scheduled for early June.
Yeah. Okay, great.
Okay.
Thank you so much.
Mark, you're up.
Okay, Mr. Chairman, I'd like to move that we adjourn.
I will second that.
Okay, Commissioner Lyons?
Aye.
Commissioner Forrest?
Aye.
And the chair votes aye. It was a very productive meeting, and thank the staff and the administrative.